So all the limbs are not stiffness. If it is stiffness, then you have to think about tetanus. All limbs are flexible. You can easily flex the limbs. Okay, it's a very classical one. Polyencephalomalacia. You can treat it with the vitamin B1, thiamine. It's a very good dramatic effect will be there. This is another case. Even it is commonly occurs in kids also. Not only in adults, it's also commonly in kids. Whenever the rumen is developed, this polyencephalomalacia will exhibit. So it's a 4-month-old kid. See, it's not lying down. Once you make the animal to one side, it's trying to get up with the other side. So it shows the signs of neurological signs. It's due to thiamine deficiency. So how to differentiate these things? The same picture. Here the stiffness is there. All the four limbs are stiffness is there. That is tetanus. When your mouth is not able to open, locked jaw, that is tetanus. Raised head. Sometimes you may be getting some things in a goat or a calf like this. All the limbs are stiffness will be there. Raised head is there. So this is tetanus. So this is how we have to differentiate from the other conditions. How to treat polyencephalomalacia? You can supplement vitamin B1, thiamine. Whatever preparation which contains thiamine, you can give. And you can give actual doses 10 milligram per kg body weight for every 6 hours. So you cannot give for every 6 hours for 4 times a day. So you can go up to 40 milligram per kg body weight. And don't use any preparation of having a B-complex preparation, which is having the liver extract as a IV preparation. So liver extract means you have to give only IM. So thiamine, so you better go for a B1, B12, B6 preparation. Any preparations which is available in the market can be used. And you have to give intramuscular injection. If you are going for IV preparation, you have to mix it with the normal saline or DNS and give it. Or dilute with the normal saline and give slow IV. Otherwise, if you are giving directly any vitamin direct IV, the animal may go for sometimes anaphylaxis will be there. So take care when you are giving IV. So it's better to mix it with the fluids. When you give it in the fluids, the dramatic result will be there. Within 1 or 2 days, the animal will become normal. Excellent result will be notice. Vitamin B1 supplementation can be given. So many preparations are available in the market that you can follow. Only the thing, when you are giving IV preparation, verify it should not have any liver extract. Otherwise, you can use it. This is the another one. So the farmer will be asking the polyencephalomalacia regarding the prognosis. Earliest presentation, the prognosis will be very good. Delayed presentation, even after 5 days of treatment, the animal is not able to get up. Paddling is there. Neurological signs is there, means it causes irreversible damage. That is called cerebrocortical necrosis. So that is called cerebrocortical necrosis. In such animals, the prognosis would be unfavorable. So we can assess the prognosis in 1 or 2 days, and so that you can tell the farmers. This is another one. Sheep, a full-term sheep, it is brought to our hospital with the coma stage. That is the only stage. It's not urinating, not defecating. It's in the coma stage. And unable to stand. When you make the animal stand, it fell down immediately. So no other history. And rumen is palpated. When you palpate the rumen, there is no fluid splashing zone. Whenever a case comes like this, you have to look about acidosis first. Acute acidosis, ruminal acidosis. For example, you have to palpate the rumen and doing the percussion and palpation. There won't be any fluid splashing sound. If it is having fluid splashing sound, then you differentiate from acidosis. You have to think about acidosis. Here, rumen is normal in consistency. Here, the pupil is dilated. The pupil is dilated very much. And the corneal reflex is absent. See, when you touch the cornea, it's completely absent. So in acute acidosis also, corneal reflex will be absent. So as I already told, you have to palpate the rumen and differentiate whether the rumen is having fluid splashing sound or not. In acidosis, fluid splashing sound will be there. Dung will be diarrhea in nature. Here, the dung is pellety in nature. Here, see the nostrils, the nasal cavity and around the nostrils. Mucus discharge is there. Continuous mucus discharge is there. And you can able to see the dung material. It is retained in the rectum. So the dung is partially retained in the rectum. So that indicates that rectal sphincter tonicity is reduced or completely absent. So what is your diagnosis? It is a case of hypocalcemia in ewe. It's a classical sign. You need not miss this type of clinical signs. For example, in case of cow, hypocalcemia occurs after parturition. Immediately after calving, it will occur around 24 hours to 72 hours, or within 1 or 2 days, it will occur after calving in cows. But in sheep and goat, mostly in sheep, during the time of pregnancy, that too full term pregnancy, hypocalcemia occurs. So we have to ask the history whether the animal is pregnant or not. Yes, it is having full, it is full term pregnant. The animal is full term pregnant. Means you correlate with all these clinical signs. The dung is retained in the rectum. The corneal reflex is absent. Pupil is very much dilated. Animal is in the coma stage. Nasal discharge is there. All these things suggest you have hypocalcemia in sheep ewe. So treatment, you can give calcium boroglyconate IV, slow IV. You can give some 50 to 100 ml. 50 ml is more than sufficient. 50 to 100 ml, you can give slow IV. Suppose if you are very much reluctant to give calcium boroglyconate directly, or safer side, you can mix it with normal saline and give slowly. That will be helpful if you are reluctant to give as it is. But by during the course of calcium boroglyconate, immediately by about 25 ml or 30 ml, around 50 ml is going, means the animal will start showing signs of recovery. The animal will urinate, the animal will pass the dung, and secretions from the eyes will be there. The reflexes will become normal, and the animal will become normal within few minutes. The dramatic improvement will be there after the treatment. Immediately after treatment, the animal will become normal. So you will feel very happy in your diagnosis. So it's hypocalcemia in ewe occurs in the full term pregnancy. And one thing you have to tell the farmer, this hypocalcemia recurs at 8 hours interval. So if it recurs, you have to bring the animal again for the treatment. So you have to repeat for 1 or 2 times so that it will recover very nicely. This is a case of hypocalcemia in ewe. So what is the reason for hypocalcemia in ewe? Inclement climate, sudden change in the climatic conditions. Any stress related during the term of full-term pregnancy, any stress may lead to hypocalcemia in ewes. And if you diagnose it very easily by appreciating the above clinical signs, you can treat it very well, you can save the animal. And next is the another case discussion. It's a differential diagnosis of swelling in the mandible. So for example, a cow is brought to you with to your hospital, or you are going to see a case with a progressive swelling in the mandible. So different type of swelling are appreciated. So you have to appreciate which type of swelling. For example, in some calf, heifer or cow, the animal will be having jowl edema. Here the edema will be there. That is due to hypoproteinemia, worm infestation. So it will be flabby in nature, piton pressure will be there, jowl edema, soft in nature. That is due to hypoproteinemia, due to worm infestation. Sometimes you may be appreciating a hard swelling from the mandible. One side of the mandible, hard swelling will be there. And when you press palpate the swelling, it will be hard in nature. Progressive swelling, that means the farmer will be telling it is grow slowly. The swelling is coming day by day, slowly, not sudden swelling. That indicates actinomycosis. So hard swelling in the side of the mandible indicative of actinomycosis. Sudden swelling of the mandible with the temperature, mucous membrane congested, petechial hemorrhages, you have to think about hemorrhagic septicemia, HS. You have to think about HS. And in some cases, you may be thinking, coming across facial edema. Sometimes the animal may be normal. Suddenly in the morning, the farmer may see the abnormal swelling of the face with edema and eyes and the eyelids are. So you have to think about the angio, that is called angioedema, any allergic condition. Any allergic condition may also lead to this facial edema. In sheep and goat, you can easily appreciate this type of clinical sign. The ears will be very spongy in nature, and the facial edema will be there. That is due to some unknown plant poisoning. So that will lead to angioedema. So sometimes the facial edema alone will be there in the cow, sudden formation during the time of grazing. After grazing, they will bring the animal to the home. They can appreciate the facial edema is there. So you have to think about snake envenomation. Snake bite should be in the differential diagnosis. So by these all things we have to rule out one by one. As already told, in some cases of pericarditis also, you can able to appreciate the very big swelling in the face. Facial edema or submandibular edema will be noticed. I will show the pictures. By seeing the picture, you can easily identify. So facial edema or submandibular edema means you have to think about actinomycosis, hypoproteinemia, snake envenomation, hemorrhagic septicemia, and traumatic pericarditis. See, in this case, here, the swelling is there, is very obvious in the submandible. It's a very hard swelling. You have to palpate the swelling. It's not pit on pressure. It is very hard in nature. It starts from one side of the mandible and extending downwards. Sometimes it will extend downwards. It is a case of actinomycosis. Complicated case of actinomycosis, and it become recumbent. Since it is untreated, it become recumbent. And see here, here also the swelling is there. Here also the swelling is there in the mandible. And if you palpate it, it is very hard in nature. It is very, very hard in nature. It's a clear case of actinomycosis. Why there is salivation? Because of the swelling and the animal cannot able to chew, salivation is there. So by seeing this, you should not mistake it for any other cases like rabies or nothing else. So here swelling is obvious, hard swelling is there. So to rule out whether it is actinomycosis or not, just put a cystic gauze needle and aspirate, you can able to see the serosanguinous fluid or small sulfur-like granules with the foul smelling fluid will be coming from this actinomycosis. So this is also a case of actinomycosis. Here, in all these cases, to your differential diagnosis should be traumatic pericarditis. In traumatic pericarditis, jugular vein will be engorged. But in actinomycosis, jugular vein is not engorged. So there is no jugular vein engorgement in actinomycosis, and there is no positive venous stasis in the actinomycosis. And treatment for actinomycosis, you can go for penicillin. You can go for penicillin, or streptopenicillin can be given for 5 gram intramuscular for 7 to 10 days. And potassium iodide is very much effective. 10 gram orally for 10 days. You can mix 10 gram in some as an electuary, and you can give it orally and for 10 days. So this is the standard treatment. You will get a very good fruitful result. If the edema is very hard and if it is ripened, it is not coming reduced means, you can go for during the process of treatment or after the treatment, you can go for surgical opening and drainage, and you can treat it as an abscess. And in refractory cases, you can go for isoniazid. Isoniazid can be used 2.5 to 5 milligram per kg body weight orally for 30 days. And isoniazid is not advisable when the animal is pregnant. So if the animal is pregnant, don't give isoniazid. In some of the practitioners, they are using 10% sodium iodide, 70 milligram per kg body weight. You have to mix it with normal saline and give IV. But in my practice, I am not going for a sodium iodide. We are getting very good result in our practice with the streptopenicillin and potassium iodide orally itself is having a very good effect. And some other antibiotics of choice, you can go for fluorphenicol or oxytetracycline can also be tried. But anyway, the most important thing is potassium iodide 10 gram orally for 10 days with penicillin. And this is the same case. So here you see the things, the edema is there in the mandible and it is extending up to the brisket region. So here you have to palpate the jugular vein and see whether it is positive or not. I will tell you how to see the positive venous stasis. Sometimes you are going to see such a cases, you have to ask the history whether the animal is treated by someone else previously. Suppose when they have given IV fluids and it went subcutaneous, that time also it will look like brisket edema. So you should not mistake it as a traumatic pericarditis, TRP. That you should not mistake it. So you have to ask the history whether anyone has given fluids, whether it has gone subcutaneous or not. Then you have to examine the jugular vein. See, here the edema is obvious from the mandible and it is extending up to the brisket region. So here you have to differentiate, as already told, actinomycosis, traumatic pericarditis. Actinomycosis means already told here the hard swelling will be there. Hard swelling in the mandible. There is no hard swelling here. Brisket region alone swelling is there. You have to palpate the jugular vein. If it is positive venous stasis, showing positive venous stasis is there, then it is a case of pericarditis. See, we can appreciate the jowl edema here. Okay. And a case is brought to you with this type of jugular vein engorgement, brisket edema is there. So what is your diagnosis? Whether it is a traumatic pericarditis or jowl edema due to hypoproteinemia or actinomycosis. This is a differential diagnosis. Here, actinomycosis means here in the jowl, the edema will be very hard in nature. Here it is very soft. So it is not a case of actinomycosis. In actinomycosis, jugular vein engorgement won't be there. Positive venous won't be there. So here jugular vein engorgement is prominent, very easily to appreciate. Brisket edema is there. So this case is a clear case of traumatic pericarditis, that means TRP, foreign body syndrome, traumatic pericarditis. So you auscultate the heart, you can able to appreciate the abnormal heart sounds in the heart. In the earliest signs will be when you auscultate the heart, you can able to appreciate the tachycardia. The increase in the heart rate will be there. In after sometime later stage, the next stage is the friction sound will be there. You can able to auscultate the friction sound. And after that, the next stage, you can able to hear the fluid splashing sound in the heart. When you auscultate the heart, you can appreciate the fluids in the splashing sound around the pericardium. Very easily you can appreciate. In the terminal stages, when you auscultate the heart, you cannot be able to hear the heart sounds. Audibility is very much reduced or absent. So that indicates abnormal collection of the fluids in the pericardium. That is called muffled heart sound. So tachycardia, friction heart sound, friction will be there, fluid splashing sound. Then in the terminal stages, muffled heart sound will be there in pericarditis. So that you can assess the stage of the animal when it is presented very easily. So here also the jugular vein is prominent, is very, very prominent. See, it's very obvious by just by seeing this clinical case, immediately you can diagnose it is a case of traumatic pericarditis. Within just 5 seconds, you can say this is a case of traumatic pericarditis. So in all the cases, you keep the finger like this in the jugular vein. So you have to keep the finger in the jugular vein like this and see whether it is bulging or not. See, normal animal, when you keep the hand like this, the upper portion will be engorged. The lower portion will not be engorged. So that is normal. That indicates venous stasis is negative. When you keep the finger like this, when both the sides are engorged, it is positive. It is positive venous stasis and it is a case of traumatic pericarditis. Very easy to identify. This is called venous stasis test. So here you can able to appreciate the engorgement in the upper portion and the jugular vein engorgement in the lower portion also. So it's a clear case of traumatic pericarditis. Just by one method, you can say it is a case of traumatic pericarditis. Very easy to appreciate. See, you can able to see the pulsation of the jugular vein. You can able to see the pulsation of the jugular vein and you can keep the finger and see whether it is positive or not. And you also you can able to see the other clinical signs. Any other clinical signs you can observe in this video, you can rewind it in your mind. See the scapula. The scapula is deviated outside. So that is another classical sign of pericarditis. See, the scapula or the elbow joint is abducted outward. So that indicates pain in the thoracic cavity. Whenever there is any pain in the thoracic cavity, the scapula will be abducted outward. So that indicates any problem in the thoracic, any pain in the thoracic cavity. You have to think about any pericarditis or any pneumonia, aspiration pneumonia, or reticulitis. See, in this case, very obvious. So the abduction of the forelimb, and the abduction of the forelimb is very obvious. And you can able to see the scapula is deviated, outward angle deviation is there. So this indicates some problem in the thoracic cavity, especially if heart pericarditis, lungs means pneumonia, reticulum, reticulitis. These possibilities can lead to pain and the angular deviation will be noticed. So in pericarditis means you can obviously see the jugular vein engorgement will be there. This is how you have to correlate the clinical signs and come to your conclusion. See, here you can able to see the scapula deviated outward angle. And there is one another condition called pseudo pericarditis. When there is no jugular vein engorgement, brisket edema is alone there. See, like this, no jugular vein engorgement, brisket edema is there. Mucous membrane is pale. And very few cases, very rarely we used to come across like this in telluriasis. Some telluriasis we used to get such a type of cases, that is called pseudo pericarditis. Not very common, very few cases. Just for your awareness, I have included these pictures. So here you can see another one. So you can able to see the pulsation of the jugular vein. See, very prominent, engorged jugular vein is very prominent. You can able to appreciate the pulsation and the jugular vein engorgement. You can keep your finger, as already told, and verify whether it is positive or not. If positive means both the sides will be engorged. See, both the sides will be engorged. It is the earliest sign. It's the earliest sign of pericarditis. You can easily diagnose. So this also a case of jugular edema with the jugular vein engorgement, that is pericarditis. And just observe this video. So many of our practitioners during the discussion, they used to say, even after getting the obvious symptoms of jugular vein, positive venous stasis is there, Brisket edema is there, when you auscultate the heart, abnormal heart sound is there. They used to ask in the discussion in the WhatsApp or during the phone call, I have done the slope test, it is negative. So this slope test, you might have studied in the academic point in the during your UG days. The slope test and all only for the academic purpose. It's not a relevant test. It's not a confirmatory test. For example, when the animal is not coming down from the slope, it does not indicate it is having pericarditis. In this case, it's coming freely. It is a slope test. It's coming very freely and going very casually. So during walking, you can able to appreciate the one clinical sign. It is a clear case of pericarditis.